I just wanted to very quickly thank you all for coming out today. My name is Joshua Tucker, and I'm the director of the Jordan Center, and it's great to see so many of you here today, especially on a Friday afternoon at this time, so we're really appreciative for what I'm sure will be an extremely interesting talk. And it's my great pleasure to introduce my colleague Arturis Rosanis, who was away on sabbatical last year, but has now rejoined us this year back in New York at the Jordan Center, who will introduce our speaker today and will also serve as the host and moderator of today's event. So I'm gonna turn it over to Arturis. You can just come up for the introduction at least. You can sit over there later, but come up for the introduction just
All right. Hi everyone, I'm Arturis Rosanis. I'm from Assistant Professor of Politics Department. And I'm very happy to introduce Julia Sweet from Rutgers. So she's a PhD candidate, right? And she works on many diverse topics, including authoritarian regimes, religion and authoritarian regimes, terrorism, national security, media, and extremism. And today we're gonna hear about political invasions and collective memories, which I presume is a part of the dissertation project, right? Another project. Okay, so let's get started then.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to see you here. I'm delighted to be here today. Thank you very much for the invitation and for the possibility to introduce my side research. I will tell you about political manipulation of Kremlin. Of the collective memories of World War II, directly connected to the Ukrainian crisis of 2014. It's just a general introduction for my research. Right here you can see a database. The current studies scrutinize the political, as I told you earlier, political manipulations of Russian elites, the collective memories of World War II. And research covers the relatively short period of time from November 2013 to the end of April 2014. It analyzed the TV content devoted to the various aspects of the Ukrainian situation of the three most popular TV outlets in Russia, NTV, Russia First, Russia One, and the First Channel. In total, I examined, well, you can see from a table here, around 300 TV programs, including talk shows, news programs, and documentaries. Actually, this research just partially connected to my dissertation. My dissertation is about national security and digital extremist propaganda. I have to say that even before the Ukrainian crisis of 2014, the Kremlin had frequently referred back to the World War II, looking for association with the glorious facets of Soviet heritage and eyes of society. The history of Victory Day parade sequence is very persuasive in this regard. During the communist regime, the parade were conducted four times at substantial time interval, 1945, 1940, 1965, 1985, and 1990. Since 1995, the Russian authorities have made the parade an annual event, providing special financial resources from the state budget to this important ceremony. Also, I have to mention that various political players, for instance, leader of Communist Party, Gennady Zyuganov, Vladimir Zhirinovsky, also repeatedly referred to the Great Patriotic War in order to legitimize himself, widen public recognition, or underline the unity of the Kremlin. Putin's regime not only exacerbated the highly politicized content of this event, but militarized it, adding demonstration of so-called new military weapons in 2008. The manipulative potential of World War II is extremely high for a number of reasons. First of all, almost every family in the Soviet Union lost members in this war, and the total national human cost of this victory was approximately 27 million lives. This great patriotic war have never been tarnished in the minds of Russians. The modern public perception of World War II is a product of state propaganda, media, and the film industry, and widely practiced rituals. This method experience, value systems, and a knowledge for the entire Soviet generation was shaped and interpreted by a number of professionals, such as scholars, filmmakers, editors, media anchors. Indeed, in this situation where appreciation by the Russians, Russian population, appreciation of the victory of Soviet army is coupled with the reliance on TV research expertise and the absence of desire to fill knowledge gap, the government has opportunity to influence society according to current political needs. Being an effective means of nationalist mobilization in 2014, the myth of victorious war is used to construct an unofficial national narrative that presents Russia as a leading group for domestic and international, in terms of domestic and international perspective. At the same time, given the political and economical climate in Russia in the 2000s, combined with a growing regret about the former glory of the Soviet Union, the Russian people were ripe for this sort of propaganda. For the regime, the anti-Ukrainian propaganda campaign was extremely indispensable. The nationwide approval, Putin's approval, persistently declined from 2008 to March 2014. Before the Ukrainian Maidan at the end of 2013, the approval of government's work, governors, and Putin himself were constantly low. The regime began to perceive its own shaky ground and looked for effective tools that could restore it. Power balance. As a result, anti-Ukrainian propaganda aimed to achieve the following objectives. First of all, to identify the enemy and the subverts of peace in Russia, constructing a strong association between Nazism and revolt against corrupted regime in Ukraine, weaken the protest potential within Russian society and undermine public sympathy for the Russian opposition, increase Putin's rating and prolong the regime's life, rally Russian population over the regime. The main precondition for success this anti-Ukrainian propaganda was a total political control of Russian government over media. I have to say that nowadays vast majority of Russian TV channels falls under government control. And by the beginning of the Ukrainian Maidan in 2014, the state has exerted almost full control. Paradoxically, the increasing state control does not undermine the reputation of TV outlets in the eyes of society, and TV remains the primary source of news. Russians received more than 90% of all news from a TV. And 51% of the TV viewers get information only from one TV outlet on a regular basis. According to Levada survey conducted in 2014. Also, according to the same center, Levada Center, most Russians prefer to receive information only from these three channels, which I covered here, NTV, Russia One, and First Channel. Blind trust among the public largely predetermined success for unfolding anti-Ukrainian campaign. And despite the overall decline of public trust in TV media from 79% in August 2009 to 50% in March 2015 and 41% in November 2015, still 59% of Russians have no doubts about the quality of information and objectivity of domestic media covering in, events in Ukraine. More than 80% of respondents believe that Ukrainian government, supported by powerful Western states, launched an informational war against Russia and concocted a huge amount of false information about the difficult situation in Donbas and Russian engagement in conflict. Therefore, society has maintained a high level of trust in TV channels, and even with the presence of alternative media sources such as Ukrainian media TV channels or even Russian TV channel Dozhd, it's in Russian, TV Rain. The population does not seem to make much an effort to find the truth. Analyzing the coverage of these three media outlets, I underline several similarities in them. First of all, it's coverage, range of coverage. Second, the character of media evaluation and the government involvement. About coverage. Since the end of 2013, these channels provided steady and extensive coverage of the Ukrainian events at expenses of domestic news, whose coverage has been reduced dramatically. These media sources cover an identical range of issues and opinions, provide expertise from the same public figures almost to the exclusion of opposing or controversial views. Character of evaluation on these three channels has become extremely negative, suspicious, and emotionally aggressive. Assuming that, first of all, the United States and Europe have sinister motivation in undermining Russia's reputation on the global stage. Another thing that I have to highlight here, Russian reporters observed the Ukrainian events as a venture of neo-Nazi activists and neo-fascists. Such a highly selective approach becomes a common practice, focusing predominantly on the Russian government's view of the situation in Ukraine. The crisis in Ukraine has modified the role of media in Russia. For now, reporters have to keep the collective memories of the World War II vivid in the public imagination. More, they must bridge these memories to they must bridge their memories of World War II with a modern event in Ukraine in a politically designed and needed way. Government involvement, ownership of media matters. Channel administrators display a great deal of deference respect to Putin's regime. Undoubtedly, I didn't find direct evidence of it. However, indirect evidence and experts' opinion allows me to make this conclusion that government directs and rules the media coverage in the Russian Federation, controlling information about everything that media presents to the public. By doing this, the elite seeks to frame situation and images in a short-term way to advance their own goals. Also, starting from the fall 2014, the Russian TV, the structure of Russian TV coverage was modified on these three outlets, first of all, in response of political needs to the Kremlin. All TV programs such as Today on MTV channel, Evening with Vladimir Solovyov on Russia One, and Politics on First Channel shifted their attention to different aspects of the Ukrainian crisis. Also, TV channels surprised viewers with many new shows, which were designed initially as a socio-political. For instance, Time Will Show on the First Channel, A Structure of Moment on the same channel, or The List of Norkin on MTV. This process has unfolded hand in hand with new approach to human resource management. Some reporters were fired because they don't have a flexible approach to the current political situation. Some of reporters have openly rejected to provide the government's stance on TV. For instance, Vanidze was fired, Nikolai Vanidze was fired from MTV channel. Evgeny Lesnoy voluntarily quit because he couldn't work in this kind of negative, highly emotional, aggressive atmosphere. In addition, channels hired some loyal reporters. For instance, in September 2014, MTV began airing a new talk show, The List of Norkin. I mentioned this show previously. New reporter Andrew Norkin, who became its host, he was actually previously unknown for the Russian people, for Russian audience. But he proves his readiness to support and defend any very much Kremlin action and initiative. In general, these changes, alterations on TV coverage lead to institutionalization of propaganda mechanism in Russia, making personal loyalty to the Russian regime more important than professionalism. As a result, the content of these channels have become highly politicized. On one hand, this allows the rising and the shaping of political consciousness of the Russians, common people, in direction needed for Kremlin. On the other hand, it's undermined the public's sympathy for the opposition, Russian opposition to the regime, and stopped the rising of protest potential within the Russian society. In my research, I covered just a part of propaganda methods, not all of them, just a part of them, but the most important part, in my opinion. referring to collective memories about the World War II, the media has adopted classic methods of propaganda. First of all, name calling, testimonials, transfer of associations, and repetition. Name calling proves to be one of the most effective tools for a number of reasons. First of all, the array of names used by Russian TV reporters is relatively small, but the names are extremely catchy. They include like Ukrafashist, Ukrainian fascist, neo fascists, Benderovtsy, followers of Stepan Bandera, neo-Nazi and Nazis. Given the significant emotional power of Russians' memories of World War II, this recollection immediately conjured up analogies with the current political situation and players such as the rebels in Ukraine and the regime opponents in Russia. In various combinations, Russian TV reporters have persistently repeated these names, trying to entrench them in public mind and establish strong associations with Ukrainian event. The label also immediately provoked negative emotions within the population, which keep alive the memory of World War II. Given the fact that every TV channel used the same names, repetition, then presenting news about Ukraine, the majority of Russians received the wrong impression about the legitimacy of this labeling. They accepted at a face value without demanding any concrete evidence. Being a part of the fight for the regime's survival, many political figures officially used the same names. For instance, Putin, Russian president, Gennady Zyuganov, Zhirinovsky, Vladimir Zhirinovsky, and others, and other people, public figures. It's interesting that in 2015, TV became more cautious in its usage. First of all, talk show guests and government officials rarely use these names. The TV propaganda has changed its preferences and operates now by names such as nationalists or extremists. One of the main reasons for this change is the failure of Putin's ambitions on Donbass. And he doesn't want to continue this military involvement. And therefore, the acute need for public support fades away and media outlets change the rhetoric accordingly. Another method, extremely productive, testimonials. I divided this method on two informal categories in terms of consumption of information by people. I'll explain it to you. In the testimonials convey first type of testimonials convey the opinion of public figures. First category, I didn't explain it to you. It's actually testimonies by created by actual people, like veterans of World War II from Poland, Ukraine, Russia, politicians, including people from Putin's administration, and other people like that. Indirect testimonies in this context, it's publishing of archival documents. So, informal categorization of testimonials. So, about the first category. These TV channels provide widely used testimonials, such figures as a politician, but, for instance, Alexander Zakharchenko, it's field commander, very popular at that time, Igor Girkin, Oleg Solov from Donbass. Nikita Mikhalkov is a very famous filmmaker in the Russian Federation and Soviet Union. Information received from these individuals looks very persuasive in the eyes of ordinary folks. Especially if propagandist message is constant and repeated. Girkin and Zakharchenko, who were active participants in the battles against the Ukrainian army in Eastern Ukraine, became widely known to Russian viewers through multiple interviews and news programs on MTV Russia One and the First Channel. In contrast to these field commanders, many prominent Russian individuals whose opinion and ideas serve as a model to common Russians have an opportunity to convey their stance through not only news programs as Girkin or Zakharchenko, but through various talk shows, such as Evening with Vladimir Solovyov, or Time Will Show on the First Channel, and Structural Moment on the First Channel. For emotional resonance, the media produced many reports with kind of testimonies. However, they widely use the testimonies of ordinary folks, as I told you already, for instance, veterans of World War II from various countries. As well as refugees from Eastern Ukraine or volunteers from that regions, ordinary militants and other people. Such emotional presentations a very effective strategy of persuasion, first of all. On one hand, this strategy does not demand digging the facts, details, professional integrity or skills from reporters. On the other hand, TV viewers petrified by war atrocities don't ask for evidence or any proof taking reporters' ethnic dignity for granted. The request for analytical appeal is missing from both sides, creators, reporters, and audience. The logical structure of these testimonies allows reporters to associate contemporary stories with the past by mixing sorrowful narratives with the comments of people from Donetsk, Lugansk, and veterans of World War II. These are images of marches of the right sector group in 2014-2015 and the Nazi army in the 1940s. About indirect testimonies. In April, March-April 2014, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Ministry of Defense published several archival documents about the activities of Stepan Bandera and his militants in Ukraine and Poland during the World War II. For a long time, these historical documents were highly classified, only few researchers had access to them. It's actually reports of Soviet guerrillas, of officers, soldiers of Soviet army became open for public. There is a lot of evidence about war atrocities committed by Ukrainian nationalists, as well as evidence of their cooperation with the Nazi regime. This propaganda event was widely advertised by these TV channels and helped to establish, first of all, the legitimacy of the media focus on fascism, and second thing, the credibility of the propaganda campaign. Even people who did not read or at least skim over these documents, this action Russian government made them sure that Ukrainian Maidan was a creation of neo-fascists, fascists and followers of the Nazi collaborator Stepan Bandera. Also, this action increased the trust of Russian population in media and Putin's regime. To explain your association, I'll just provide example documentary. This documentary was transferring association, method of propaganda transferring of associations. In 2013, at the end of 2013, the NTV channel created documentary, Technology of Maidan. Actually, it was just the beginning of the chain of documentaries devoted to various aspects of the Ukrainian crisis. At that time, the focus on fascism and propaganda, at the end of 2013, I'm talking about, the focus on fascism and propaganda did not reach its culmination. And to undermine the inner opposition, filmmakers employed well-known strategy, the presentation of oppositional leader in Russia, as a Western puppet, and protest actions as a threat to peace inside of Russia. On one hand, this documentary, Technology of Maidan, vividly depicted the transformation of civil protests in Kyiv into full-fledged violence, transferring this association to peaceful demonstrations at Bolotnaya Square in Moscow 2011-2012. According to the logic of this documentary, this uprising of the Russian opposition was preliminary stage of uncontrollable violent actions, which were fortunately prevented by the Russian government. On the other hand, it reveals that so-called conspiracy of the predatory West and the Ukrainian corrupt and patriotic opposition against the Ukrainians. Further in this documentary, the West West domestic opposition conspiracy pattern was transferred to the Russian anti-government resistance. The documentary presented Putin's regime as a strong government that saved society from plunging into bloody bath. The government used the media outlets for public condemnation of opponents' views, and negative publicity seriously undermined the domestic opposition in Russia. In total, from December 2013 to March 2015, this channel created approximately 14 documentaries, and 11 of them were devoted to Ukraine. Another interesting propaganda tool at that time is talk shows. In fact, talk shows aired in this period of time imitated the scripted character and scripted character and spontaneous form of public participation. Several methods help to accomplish it. First of all, selective approach to participants. Preliminary monitoring of participants' positions on crucial issues and host engagement in discussions. In a talk show format, participants include, first of all, media professionals, journalists, politicians, experts, scholars, representatives of various government organizations, and ordinary people. However, the first two categories, experts and professionals, are common guests on the TV shows. But appearances of ordinary folks depends on a discussion certain topics and appropriateness of emotional potential of their contributions. The frequency of the TV appearances for public figures depends on their loyalty to Kremlin. Therefore, as you can understand, that members of political parties were made up the State Duma, like United Russia, Communist Party, I guess of talk shows on the federal, these federal channels, most often. The people who are known to be critical to Kremlin policy also may be invited, but the format of these programs forces some opponents to decline invitations. Still, there are some who accepted. For example, I remember I watched TV Rain, Dosht, outlet, and its political expert Stanislav Vilkovsky noted that he repeatedly rejected invitations from federal channels due to their unfair treatment and extremely biased approach. Most of the time, opponents, first of all, they have less time to present their position, and then their presentation contain valuable, persuasive arguments. They endure frequent and sudden interruptions from, first of all, talk show hosts. Sometimes they were interrupted by background noise. In addition, talk show discussion deliberately maintained underrepresentation of opponents, and the number of guests with anti-government views is fewer than the number of supporters of the regime. Such emotional format of the programs undermines the demand for valid argument and facts, making rational analysis look very unpersuasive and often overshadowed by emotional bluff. In this regard, the role of host, talk show host, is very interesting. First of all, I forgot to switch a slide, excuse me for that. About hosts. The role of host is defined by propagandist goals. Moderators allows the pro-government side to openly mark or loudly show negative emotion towards opponents. During programs, hosts don't try to mitigate conflicts or reach some kind of agreement between speakers or to undermine proper peaceful, at least peaceful position for a viewing audience. Hosts always take a pro-government stance. Being the main voice of propaganda, TV shows don't look for presentation of alternative perspectives or contrasting views on various social political issues. Instead, their pivotal purpose is to deliver and entrench the government's position in the public mind. However, not all talk shows practice such emotional appeal. Some of them have a peaceful communication style with a slow lecture type discussion. For example, on Russia One, winning the project special correspondent, специальный корреспондент in Russia. Arkady Mamontov has launched a TV program this TV program used to be a hybrid of talk show and documentary. Between January 2014 and March 2014, 43 programs were aired, and all of them covered the situation in Ukraine. This format allowed him to mix the entertaining character of TV shows with the serious political issues. His show follows a particular format. At the beginning, the host presented a new documentary, and then guests discussed issue covered by the documentary. Experts who starred in this documentary used to be key figures of discussion. That increased the legitimacy of the documentary message. Interesting that slow-moving discussion between invited political figures and intellectuals is agitated by aggressive appearances repeatedly. He was extremely aggressive. Mamontov himself, host and the creators of this documentary. Sometimes he used very derogatory labels and even crossing remarks toward opponents. To sum up, I have to say that trying to buy some time, the Kremlin has launched a massive anti-Ukrainian propaganda campaign. The pro-government TV outlets play a crucial role in delivering the regime's ideas, achieving a desired effect towards protesters and shaping political opinion. TV channels enjoy a larger reach as well as absence of media plurality in the Russian media market, which makes them extremely influential. While the number of pro-government media in Russia is essential, the segment of divergent voices presented only by one channel, Dozhd TV Rain. Through historical narratives, the media has successfully employed many classic methods of propaganda and breach the collective memory of World War II with the modern protests in Ukraine. Given the political and economical decline in Russia in the 2000s, combined with the growing nostalgia about the former glory of Soviet Union, the Russian people were ready to listen and digest this negative anti-Ukrainian campaign. As I told you already, but I want to underline that today the rhetoric of the media has become more careful and less aggressive. The fascist trend has begun to lose its actuality and popularity due to political changes in the Russian Federation. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, I'm ready to answer.
Thanks, Yulia, for very extensive presentation of the anatomy of what's going on in Russian media. So if you have questions, probably you should just introduce yourself and in two words where you're from and do a question.
Hi, I'm Matt Vitakor, I'm a faculty fellow here in Russian Islamic Studies. And I have two questions, if that's okay. The first one is, how are the propaganda, like the propaganda bombardment that we're seeing now, how is it different or similar to the like compromat-laden information wars that started happening in the late 90s already, in particular on like the first versions of the internet? And then the second question, sort of related to that, like how do you see the role of the internet in all of this? Because it's true that like TV is the main source of news for people, and Dozhd is the sort of the only remaining independent source. But there are things like, you know, Alexei Navalny has a YouTube channel, mm-hmm. with many subscribers.
Including me.
Right, exactly. And me. So Yes, if you could just like work, like how does that fit into your view of things?
Thank you for this question. I believe it was part of my research, actually. Let's start from the second question. Actually, the Russian people, even though they have access to internet, it's expensive, but it's accessible anyway. For their subjective reason, they prefer to believe in TV channel information rather than look for reliable information, controversial, not reliable, controversial information on internet. They expect it, they don't expect to get a truth from internet, but they're not ready to analyze themselves the controversial information that they can find there. For instance, one of the reasons why the coverage of TV, Russian TV media was changed on the fall 2014, one of the main reasons used to be the information, if you remember, information presented by Leo Schlossberg, Lev Schlossberg in Russian, it's political politician from Pskov region. He presented information, he revealed information about deaths, several, five or six, I don't remember exactly, soldiers from Pskov. They were killed in Ukraine, and the Russian government tried to conduct a hidden funerals in Pskov. And this explosive information, explosive infusion, was extremely dangerous for Russian government. And Leo Schlossberg was attacked 3 days after revealing this information. And thanks God, he's alive and he's good now, nowadays, in good health condition. And Russian government decided, I think, partially in relation to this event. This information, by the way, was spread from internet resources. In order to confront this kind of controversial information on the future, the Russian government launched aggressive, emotionally unprecedented anti-Ukrainian propaganda campaign. And once again, Russians are not ready to, first of all, to conduct search on their own in internet. They don't want to compare information. They don't want to analyze this information on their own. It's much better, much easier for them just to take information from TV channels as a grant.
And what about the first question?
The first question, I analyzed the TV coverage between the end of 2014 and April of 2015, and after that I just switched channel, because it's honestly, it's emotionally very difficult to watch this content even for research. It's extremely difficult to watch, especially evening with Vladimir Solovyov. You have to be ready for that emotionally. And honestly, and after that I get another research project, and I didn't watch Russian TV for a long time, excuse me. So I can provide expertise on it.
Hi, I'm Bruce Grant from the Department of Anthropology, and I want to go back a little bit to conclusion number three here, because I liked everything you were saying. I certainly understand where it's all going, but I always want to rest on this paradox. How is it that we got so quickly to the kind of easy conclusion that seems to be everywhere, not just in your presentation, that the Russian people were right for this, right? Because only X number of years ago, the close of the USSR, we're looking at a country that persuasively appeared to have the highest rate of literacy in the world. We had a population only 25 years ago that was probably better trained than any part of the world to reading between the lines, generation after generation after generation. You have even people who hadn't been recruited to this. You know, you have the full flush of perestroika and all of the analysis and critical skills that went into that, that
mm-hmm.
were just on television in a country that already was pretty addicted to television and already had a pretty rich tradition of working with the papers, even though the papers were government run, right? So the internet comes into this, but we still have the TV, we still have the papers, and not just you, but most people now tell us that, as with the Levada Center, that everyone just stopped, right? They just stopped.
Mm-hmm.
Can you go back to that again in some way? You gave a line or two, right? We can think about the humiliation of the Russian people and they just get kind of tired. So we could diversify the Russian people into lots of different strains across. But that's where I keep coming back. Why?
I believe that it's absence of alternative. They don't see alternative. I think Russian, majority of Russians, yeah, maybe in the 90s and looking for some kind of prosperity, future, brilliant future for Russia. But in the 2000s, they changed their even focus of future. They lost their hopes, in my opinion, they lost their hopes. And they didn't see any alternative to this political regime. Because if you ask Russians, if you check surveys of Levada Center, I believe only surveys, Levada surveys, only believable, it can provide some kind of reliable information about situation in Russia and what really Russians think. They lost their focus in this modern world. As a result, due to this absence of belief in future, in their own future, they get back to the past. And Soviet past.
Yeah, so just on this exact same point, because Bruce sort of asked the question that I wanted to ask as well, which is like, okay, so you just told us people were upset, people were
mm-hmm.
had lost hope, but like, you could have said the exact same argument and said people were upset, they lost hope, and they became completely cynical about the news media, right? And so they're not going to believe anything they see
mm-hmm.
on television in this circumstance. And then, and the other thing about it, when they say they were right for this sort of campaign, I could also imagine we're sitting here having this discussion and people are saying, well, there was this abortive attempt by Yeltsin to portray Ukrainians as against Russia's national interest. But Ukrainians have always been the little brat, you know, the little brother, and it didn't work because to break the Russian-Ukrainian bond was such a strong bond to have. So I am completely willing to buy that there was propaganda. I'm completely willing to buy the idea that there are these strong attitudes
mm-hmm.
in support of the war in Ukraine. Like both, I don't deny either of those things. And I buy, we can have long discussions about how to interpret public opinion data, but for the most part, I buy there's a lot of support for there. It's this number three here, that they were right for this sort of campaign. Again, I have the same thing. Why would you not, you know, you had a same, and I asked Artoris the same question in a different talk 2 days ago,
mm-hmm.
right? Why would you think, or maybe Bruce asked it in the talk 2 days ago, why would you think that people who, exactly as this Bruce has said, who were so cynical of news media and so sensitive to propaganda,
mm-hmm.
why are we now just saying, oh yeah, these are the people, it's so easy to manipulate this population in this
mm-hmm.
in this era 20 years later?
Can I just a short interjection? So if I remember correctly, the number that you cited, the people who believe that the Russian media represents the situation in Ukraine correctly was 59, you said?
59%, yep.
I mean, it's a number that is actually much smaller than I would have expected. So 41%.
Yeah, okay, so
that, which
yeah,
is,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Let's sort of have this number in mind. Given the political situation in Russia, where perhaps, you know, you have some desire not to always say that you don't trust the media. So that number is pretty actually much lower than I would have. And also, it's a situation where you ask the question in the context of whatever you have, it's a war, right? So if you ask the question about supporting the government or believing the government control media in time of war, in pretty much every country is going to be a large number of people who just express the support for the hell of doing that, even
right.
if they actually
But so I would say just the causal arrows could go in the opposite direction, right? that the causal arrows are, you like Putin because Putin has given you hope after the economic collapse of the 1990s, because you have the economic replacement. Because you like Putin, you're predisposed to like things Putin does. Putin does something that is pretty popular with a large degree of society. Mm-hmm. And so then you don't really particularly turn a skeptical eye to the media, even if you know the media is feeding you some bullshit over some of this stuff, right? The same exact thing as in the United States, where people say, oh, Trump just came down to Alabama and endorsed Luther Strange, but he really means like he's going to endorse, you know, like we can ignore what everybody's telling us here. But so it's a very different causal picture than saying that this is successful propaganda. So that's, I think like we're all agreeing on four of the pieces being in place here. It's just a question of whether we should be drawing the causal arrows. So under my story, it means the media goes and says all this stuff, and people, they're either primed to want to believe it's true, or primed to like pick up on the message, or even stronger in opposition to the causal arrows would be, oh, this is great, this is additional evidence I can take to reinforce my worldview that we did the right thing in Ukraine, mm-hmm. right? But that's really different from saying, absent this propaganda, people wouldn't have thought that they did the right thing in Ukraine, that the propaganda took these easily susceptible, you know, poor peasants watching TV who would have normally been opposed to this and suddenly turned them into great supporters of this Ukrainian inversion, you know,
Crimea annexation. You missing part, propaganda. Propaganda was extremely effective. Anti-Ukrainian propaganda was extremely effective. I conducted survey after, I didn't mention one of the methods of propaganda here. I conducted a survey. It's approximately 50 people from a different background. Some of them were academics from Russia, some of them PhD students, some of them just electricians and blah blah. Interesting thing. All of them told me that we didn't watch TV on a regular basis. It's so annoying, sick of it, don't want to watch TV, especially news. My next question used to be, What actually you watch sometimes on the TV, or movies, or TV dramas, okay. Then I start to watch movies on Russian TVs and TV dramas. I found it extremely interesting thing. Between movie, for instance, 1 hour, 20 minutes. And every movie divided on equal parts. And between the equal parts, you can see announcement, like promotion. Every promotion, commercial promotion usually, but every commercial promotion started from some kind of catchy, totally false and absurd cliché phrase, like Poroshenko sold Ukraine to West, blah, blah, blah. So this is extremely crazy, but catchy phrase. And approximately every movie got 5 to 6 commercial pauses, you know? And I decided to ask these people about what's going on if you don't watch news, what's going on, how do you know all this information about Ukraine from these promotions? Because you know, another important thing what I figure out, these people, respondents, they use cliché phrases to explain me the situation in Ukraine, the same cliché phrases. You know, they don't even try to rephrase it somehow, explaining what's going on in Ukraine right now in Donbass and Russian involvement and the conflict, all of that. No, they're just presenting these phrases from promotions, let's call it commercial promotions. You know, it's like advertisement of new talk shows, for instance, for Vladimir Solovyov.
Yeah. No,
is crazy, and these people absolutely sure that they know everything about Ukraine.
Right, I'm
but
not pushing
they
you
use
on
this vocabulary. Outrageous. And propaganda is extremely effective. You know, oh my God, I was stupid enough, excuse me. I published this article on my Facebook. And my relatives from Europe, they, partially, I think, no, not at all, they read it. In 2 weeks, I received a nasty message. from my relatives. They live for a long time in Europe. And the nicest word which they describe me used to be traitor. Because of that. So propaganda is extremely effective, not only the Russian geographical scale in Russia, but outside for Russian immigrants. Extremely effective. They don't want to even listen what European media present for them as alternative source.
Mm-hmm. All right, yes.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. My name is Maria. I'm the anthropology department as well. And just on your last point of this traitor aspect, I think that's really important. And I think it's very telling that there's something else in the body of news besides data to be credited or discredited, believed or disbelieved. There are stakes being made and stakes being bought into that have nothing to do with facts.
Mm-hmm.
But like facts, these stakes are cumulative. So since the beginning of, you know, open television news and all these things, like after the fall of the Soviet Union, TV and media in general took on a completely different life and a cumulative kind of veracity that everybody had to buy into in order for it to work at all. And I think that that's partly what's going on here, and it's not necessarily that, and that makes it so difficult to measure, right? Because how do you measure not necessarily whether you believe in something or whether it's true, but how much it's actually worth,
mm-hmm.
how much the meaning is actually worth. And so I was curious, where do you have, or do you experience other kinds of gaps, or rather, maybe gap isn't the right word, but what you're saying here, where people like yourself who, you know, put all this effort into making this research, this body of knowledge, where people value you based on some kind of misinterpreted ideology as opposed to the facts are. Like, where do viewers betray their sources of news or their television programs? And where do those programs also betray the viewers? Like, show something that it doesn't matter whether it's factual or not factual, but like that betrays the trust of the viewer. I'm not sure if I'm making myself quite clear, and I'm sorry for that, but where are other sites of betrayal that you get between the viewer and the media that don't have to do with the factual credibility of that media?
Interesting question. I mentioned that human management, actually media media began to change even people, its anchors, in order to construct this whole coverage in directed politically designed way. So I think it's not about credibility even, it's about professionalism, I believe. Professionalism means, in my opinion, maybe it's just my opinion, professionalism directly connected to ethics, specific ethics, which not flexible ethics, but ethics for centuries. Interesting thing. I hope I answered your question, but interesting, I'll think about it.
All right, wait, one more question than that.
Can you please describe more the role of the United States in all of this model? Because it seems to me that many people saw Ukraine not as, you know, like equal opponent, but as a puppet of Obama, and like as not the direct opponent of Russia. So I mean, you did all this analysis on Ukraine, but like, where was the United States were they important in there? And another question is, it seems to me that many of these methods were tested during the war with Georgia in 2008, like many of what you were saying. So did you analyze that a little bit, or like did you look at it or not? And what are your ideas about it? And another, like the just practical question is, was there any effect of war on mistakes? Because I know that like there were at least two cases when these main TV channels, they gave the story that wasn't, that they admitted that was false at the end, like was this crucified boy. And another one when they interviewed the guy, like different channels interviewed him, and for different channels he gave the different opposite stories. And then they admitted it. So was there any effect of that, like, because they admitted it publicly as well, yes? I mean, it did work somehow. So thank you.
Thank you very much for the story. Start from the beginning, United States. At that time, the end of 2013, the April 2015, Obama was a common topic on TV. Obama and the role of United States. Yep, Ukraine was presented as a puppet, as I told you already, and we agree on it, so, as a puppet of United States. It was a common common story, common myth that was implemented in the public mind through various these TV channels. No, I didn't focus on role of, specifically, I didn't focus on role of description of role of United States in this crisis. I just look at it in terms of look at the anti-Ukrainian propaganda in terms of the collective memories of World War II. And about the Georgian War, no, I didn't do any comparison. This one anti-Georgian anti-Georgian campaign and anti-Ukraine. No, I didn't do, maybe I should do that. Yeah, you're absolutely right. And about false stories, they happened a little bit later, so I didn't cover it. No, about the dead boy, so-called dead boy, crucified somewhere. It's absolutely crazy story, yeah, concoct story, yeah, on Russian TV. No, but it's once again, it's a false story. False story is very effective and productive methods, propaganda, because usually people, they listen the first initial source, that's it, and after that, any kind of excuses or explanation, nobody cares pretty much, just a small part of population are interested in some kind of explanation of the whole story behind the falsification. Pretty much nobody cares. So the false story.
I wanted to ask like a question. So to the extent that 1/6 of the Second World War Soviet casualties were actually Ukrainians. So when the World War II narrative is invoked to sort of promote anti-Ukrainian position, does this fact in any way backfire with the viewers? I mean, I presume a lot of them have learned this fact at some point in their lives, in you know, history classes, etc. It's a very common knowledge that many important battles of the World War II were fought in Ukraine, and there were many Ukrainian casualties in that war. So does that play any role in that discourse?
Not really. You know, in order to connect the current situation, this the World War II, these TV channels have showed on a regular basis symbols of the right sector group and Svoboda. They resemble these symbols. Their symbols resemble these Nazi symbols, and as a result, transfer of association. Once again, works right here.
Can I add something just to your point? And this is something I just wanted to, do we have time for?
I guess we still have time. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm just interested in how. I mean, obviously obviously Ukraine's own news media is not part of your study, mm-hmm. but in my experience with it, they have distanced themselves from being members of the Red Army. At least in 2013, when I was living in Ukraine, there were lots of May 9th parades. Pretty much every city, they had one. Now they are pretty rare in Ukraine to celebrate Victory Day. So there is also this distancing from Ukraine itself of this shared legacy of fighting in World War II, and to some extent, the elevation of people like Bandera. Mm-hmm. It is happening in Ukraine. I mean, I am not saying
yes,
what the Russian media is saying about mm-hmm. Bandera, but definitely, if you're trying to look for, you know, if you go to a museum about World War II or you go to an exhibit or something, it's definitely going to emphasize Bandera and Lupa more than it emphasizes the Red Army. Mm-hmm. So I think that in that case, I don't know, and I didn't know if any of your research deals with how the Ukrainian media is also using its position to kind of create a new collective memory of World War II there.
Yeah, so I think this topic deserves a separate study.
Yeah.
So I didn't cover it. It was too much. It's a little bit out of my focus. Yeah, it's connected, definitely, for sure, but I think it deserves a separate topic. Very interesting. Thank you very much. Good idea.
Yeah. Rudolf Hauser, retired economist. If I recall correctly, didn't some of the Ukraine from the western section fight with the Nazis, join them, and has that played a part in associating this current Ukrainian position with the Nazi fascist idea?
Mm. It's very difficult to answer immediately, to be honest. Another thing what I didn't mention here, for instance, I hope I will answer your question. In 2010, Oleg Tsanyuk, I hope I pronounce it correctly. It's a Ukrainian politician, a leader of nationalist Svoboda political party, was awarded Golden Cross by former member of the German SS military division. And Russian TV, Russian channels found, I don't know where, but they found the pictures of this event, and as a result, they presented these pictures from 2010, pictures of Ukrainian Maidan, and the second, third segment, situation in Russia in the 1940s, the German army attacked the Soviet Union. And it's how the images presented, once again, it's transfer of association and Russian channels, they connected these totally separate events by images. 2010, Ukrainians, extremist, Ukrainian Maidan, and fascist invasion in the forest. And after that, people don't ask, Russian viewers, they don't ask about some kind of facts. They don't want to read the actual base, and they don't try to investigate how these images connect to each other, the background story.
I think there's like a different way to look at it. The collaboration of West Ukrainians and in many other places in Eastern Europe of locals with the Nazis is an established fact. What is interesting here is that it became a centerpiece of Russian media, an obsession with that fact, and Russian media started only after the start of Maidan. So like in 2005, four earlier, it was never really a big thing over there,
mm-hmm.
because Ukrainian leadership was taking the position that Russian leadership enjoyed. And that fact became a saving fact on the TV screen only when it was politically relevant for Russia. So in that context, I think this is what's important.
Mm-hmm.
The fact itself is beyond denial. Mm-hmm. No.
Yeah, and very interesting thing that archival documents were published, I mentioned this fact, in April 2014. These documents actual base for the research and the propaganda.
I have a question about some of the limits of facts, you know, actual like, statistics or research, because sometimes, you know, my parents would watch like Channel 1, and as you described, I would sometimes watch it, and there are very like graphic pictures there, and sometimes the music is very disturbing. So it has some sort of traumatizing effect, and it's very emotionally laden. So, you know, if let's say if we understand rationally what's going on, how is it possible to transmit that information in a way that other people would be able to actually, you know, take it inside? If, you know, we compete, let's say, with, you know, such a big machine that is using all those different techniques, don't you think that just like certain facts or statistics, people are not as likely to actually, you know, take it inside their minds and think about it?
You mean the analytical, some kind of critical approach to the propaganda from a Russian audience, yep?
Yeah, I'm just saying that there seems to be certain limits to facts.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say if we just like say certain things that this is a fact, but at the same time they watched yesterday some like horrible pictures with horrible music, with, you know, and this is their reality because that's what they experienced emotionally. Don't you think that like it's very difficult to compete with something like that?
This emotional appeal,
mm-hmm.
is supposed to be impossible because facts usually presented is a date, you know, and common folks don't keep even dates, historical dates, geographical location. Connected to facts, it's complicated. You know, most of them here that are some kind of facts. That's it. And tomorrow, definitely I will forget. You know, if I'm tired at the evening after my work, it was a busy day. You know, and however, the even false information, concocted facts, presented in some kind of emotional way. This is music, for instance, is some kind of exclamation of people, well-known people, like Nikolai Starkov, so-called writer in Russia, modern Russia. I think it's impossible to compete. It's impossible to eliminate the damage caused by this anti-Ukrainian propaganda. I think this damage, gonna get detrimental consequences even for our kids, the future generation, for sure.
Yes, one more question in the back.
Soviet publications for decades have always stressed the connection of Bandera not just with the Nazis, but with the Americans and the British, because the Americans and the British sort of,
mm-hmm.
incorporated some of the Rosenberg East Group into their own secret services as collaborators. And so my question is, when you look at the contemporary, when you're studying the Russian TV of 2014-2015, it's already the background of enormous Soviet propaganda about Bandera and World War II. So how do you account for the fact that people have already been hearing, sort of for decades, the same argument that it seems to be that Soviet TV is now, or Russian TV is now promoting, that Soviet TV promoted, you know, years earlier? In other words, how much is there a continuity, so that oftentimes when people say, well, I believe it, but I don't quite know why I believe it, well, maybe it's because for decades they've been having a variation of the same argument. And so maybe this is sort of already in people's heads, so that the TV is sort of reinforcing ideas that were sort of common in Soviet Europe.
Yeah, true. It's another reason why the Russians were right for this kind of propaganda. They were ready, exactly. They, Porsche should answer for your question. They have their own, Russian population has their own image of Stepan Bandera as a collaborator of Nazi. That's it, statement. It's an unquestionable fact in their head, yeah. And people who knew nothing about Stepan Bandera, just his name, and it's immediately associated with a Nazi collaborator label, that's it. Russian people were ready for this kind of, you know, false links between truth truth and lies, you know, and mythology. And as I told already, that all these collective memories of World War II was a creation of professionals, you know, and some kind of rituals, even filmmakers.
Right, but it's a continuity from the Soviet era. Right?
Exactly.
Right. So it's not that you're simply just right. It's because has been developing.
Yeah,
this is a trope.
Cultural connection. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But there are a lot of Soviet tropes that have not remained. I mean, kind of to what Artros was saying, that yes, this is something that was written about, but there were a lot of. It goes back to Bruce's question of, how come we can all sit here and say, well, of course they're going to believe that because that's what the Soviet narrative was. Then there are so many other Soviet narratives that are not believed anymore. So I think it does depend on time and a war and, you know, all of that stuff as well. I think it's not enough to just say that it was said and was emphasized in Soviet times.
But I think that can be somewhat explained by the fact that one thing that people did believe was the sort of the narrative of the Great Patriotic War. And this is very integrated into the Great Patriotic War as opposed to the successive collectives and some god awful place in Russia, in Khrushchev. In other words, you can separate the nationalist current within the, you know, from sort of the communist ideology, if I can put it that way.
But if I may jump in, and I think going back to your question about the stakes, and you're not a true patriot if you don't believe in the greater narrative of the Great Patriotic War, and it is very black and white. I mean, the shades of gray, just don't believe it. If you don't buy it, you're a traitor.
Right, and so that, you know, studies of state propaganda in other countries, like for example, Lisa Wiedemann's study of propaganda in Syria, also make exactly the same point, that to a large degree, the factual nature of the statements really doesn't matter. What matters is sort of the identity part of the propaganda, that because you say you believe it, you identify yourself as a member of a certain community, as a member of certain political groups. So I guess part of that logic plays here. I thought you had a question?
I did have a question.
Yes.
Actually, related to the Syrian war. My name is Angela Glubich. I'm in the IRMA program with a concentration in Russian Arab Studies. It seems to me that the propaganda effort for the Syrian war was not at the same level or intensity as the one for Ukraine, which was actually more direct Russian involvement, maybe more casualties that are visible, et cetera. So, why is it that Ukrainian conflict seem to warrant more propaganda efforts than a Syrian war, which seems to, you know, be more of a sacrifice of resources?
That's totally different thing. It's like apple and oranges. We're talking about conflict, Russian invasion in Ukraine. It's like conflict, like a civil war. mostly like a civil war, so like a war between relatives. We all talking about Russians. I'm from Russian, deep Russia. We all pretty much majority, vast majority of us Russians, we have connections with Ukrainian people, blood connections, close connections, and it's for many of us it's very difficult to separate us. It was a huge mistake of Russian government to start this conflict, these many dead people, that lead to casualties. It's very difficult to eliminate damage, as we told already discussed that. It's very difficult. It's like a conflict inside of family. But Syrian war is a different story. It's international conflict. It's the war. It's directly connected to national security, even the United States, the European countries, and different, a little bit different scale of conflict. And yeah, but it's not true partially. I remember I monitor the Islamic State outlets on media, on social media, various social media platforms, and they presented much many Russian casualties than Russian channels presented. And yeah, from both sides, from both conflicts, and Ukrainian conflicts or Syrian war, Russian government tried to hide human casualties. I don't know why, but they try to do that. If you check the information on another side of Syrian conflict, it's much more. And this usually the Islamic State outlets provide information about Russia or killed Russian militants with the pictures. Believable pictures, blonde hair, white eyes, if any. Excuse me. So I think it's different. It's like conflict. Ukrainian conflict is more close to us, to Slavic populations. Like conflict inside of our family, with a detrimental consequences for centuries between Ukrainians and Russians. But Syrian conflict is extremely the Muslim population, the Muslim part of Russian Russia, they perceive this conflict as a conflict inside of the family.
Okay, we have time for one more question. Last one, yes, please.
I have a small comment and a question. First of all, I was wondering if it's possible now to ask to have interviews with these media people and to know how they react, because you show them as propagandists. But I was wondering if they were astonished or curious about the success they have with this thematic of Ukraine, and if they are not pushed to make more and more show on Ukraine because it was very successful, that the people who are watching it. And I go to another, and I follow this idea, but as an historian, I don't use so much this term of propaganda, because normally, which is interesting for us, is to understand the reception of the propaganda. And I think what is astonishing for all of us here is more how the Ukrainian war was kind of surge of nationalist feelings. We knew we are there, but we didn't have the idea to what extent the Russian population could say, okay, we will go to Ukraine and there is no problem.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it will be useful to get some information by the people who were in charge of not constructing maybe that propaganda, but just also to have this view of how the viewer and the population was reacting. And if they really decide that they will continue this show just because it was so successful, because I think there is this kind of idea when you are in a show TV. It's the first question. And my second question, in all this kind of period of time you were looking at, do they speak also about other countries? I mean that about the Baltic state or Poland, because normally the whole narrative about the Second World War were created before, I mean, when they were a kind of war of history with other countries and Ukraine. Do they use also that, or it was totally, they were just a kind of focus on the Ukrainian-Russian relationships?
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for your questions. Yep. You catch me. Yep. Previously, before 2014, this Ukrainian propaganda, anti-Ukrainian propaganda, the Russian Russian media channels, I don't remember which one exactly, maybe several of them, presented a lot of documentaries about neo-Nazis and fascists in the Baltic countries. But this far focus, yeah, they sometimes they increment some small short stories from Baltic countries into the documentaries, for instance, on an NTV channel by Arkady Mamontov. I mentioned this guy already. Yeah, he incremented some short but catchy stories into his documentaries. Yeah, honestly, I didn't examine this segment specifically yet, but partially. These TV outlets, they try to increment short but extremely catchy for Russian audience stories from Baltic countries. And another thing, and they did it previously, more extensive, they did it previously, about talk shows, I can't say nothing about how popular used to be these TV shows, but I believe their popularity was not that high. How government analysts try to present it, popularity, honestly, because it's impossible, because of emotional appeal. It's very difficult to tolerate it day by day, you know? And nowadays, I think majority of these TV shows gone. They are gone. The List of Norkin, for sure, it's gone already from NTV channel. Maybe for 1 year already. So I don't think so that they were super popular among people, you know. Evening with Vladimir Solovyov, I think it's changing host channel. But it's still there, but I think it's not very popular, to be honest. It wasn't popular in 2013, 2014,
all right.
Due to
content. Analyst Alina Burdina, she studies these ratings of these programs,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, according to her, actually, they just started to lose popularity just recently, all these political shows.
Lost, yeah.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
I mean, but they were quite like number ones in among
mm-hmm.
the country.
Yeah, but I don't believe, honestly, I don't believe statistics presented by government about media coverage. So we have to be critical a little bit. So as a result, we don't have a reliable statistics that we can provide as a fact. So, but I believe that. These shows are not very popular among people.
All right, on that note, let's thank you for the conversation.
Thank you, and if I can just note, if you are not already on our mailing list, we have a